light each day and do your devotional. There are, I believe, 6 out there. The big one is not for the take. Just so you know, it's the 3 on either side that if you don't have them, you're welcome to take them home with you. If you also, if we run out, then go get yourself a candle. That's easy enough, right? Or you have one at home, light that. Also, Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock, we will have worship. I'm not sure yet if we will be online. We'll try and make that happen, just so you know. 7 o'clock here on Wednesdays, and we'll do the follow-up each week to Sunday morning. So as today we're focusing on fire or the flame and the presence of God, we'll take that just a little step further on Wednesday nights. So we have a flow as we walk through the first chapter of Luke's gospel during this Advent season. The word Advent means wait. So we are waiting, and actually we're waiting for the presence of God to come in fullness, which is the second coming of Christ, but also as we look towards that first coming. The Nativity Walk, we started last year, and it's out in our garden, our memorial garden. You can take a walk through there. You can pick up a brochure as you walk through each station of the Nativity. And at night, it will all be lit up. We have spotlights on the pictures if you want to come at night, or you can walk during the day. It's a great way for us to prepare our hearts and our minds. Different way than the world prepares, right? Everybody's buying gifts if they can get them off a boat. But for us, we are focused on the coming of Christ. Bible studies this week on Tuesday afternoon, 1 o'clock by Zoom, and at 6:30 by Zoom on Thursday, in-person Bible study. There will not be confirmation. I need to talk to the confirmation families about that. So we've got to figure out what we are doing. We are collecting for Holy Kicks, are we not?
There's 2 big boxes in the closet by the entry door.
Okay.
As you come in left. One's got quite a few shoes in it, the other one's empty. They say Holy Kicks on them.
Okay. Holy Kicks, bring your shoes in. You can put them there. Or if you want to write a check, you can write it to Bethel Lutheran. We will mark in the memo that it is for Holy Kicks. These are for shoes for the homeless or those who are living in the hotels or those who just don't have enough to buy shoes for their children and their families. So primarily it's adult shoes, but there are children who need shoes as well.
They go into schools now, Title I schools, and give to children as well. That's what Pastor Ty told us. And also he said they can get the shoes for $20 a pair. So if you can't find them for less than that, you might just want to donate. I found them online. Down for children especially, a lot less. So,
wonderful. So please keep that in mind during this season. I believe that's all the announcements I have for today. So as we light our Advent wreath, we're learning a new song, and each week we're going to be adding a verse to that song. first candle, reminding us that Jesus is God's presence in the world. Jesus is the one who hears our prayers and with compassion, and who offers guidance when we seek it. As we begin the season of Advent, we remember that our rest can be found in God through the gift of God's Son, our hope, who is forever restoring us. And let us pray. O God of hope, bring your presence to be felt. Fire us up with your love and allow your embers to burn inside of us as we long for you. Amen. I ask that you would please stand. Our worship this morning begins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's just take a moment for silence, for self-examination, and for focusing our hearts on Christ. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Thank you.
with your word and with your hope. This we ask in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ through the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for the darkness is as light to you. Here is the song. Please stand for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is according to the Gospel of St. Luke, the first chapter, verses 5 through 17 and 26 through 28. Glory be to you, O Lord. In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah. And he had a wife of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And as they both were righteous before God, walking in all commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. But they had no child because Elizabeth was barren, and both were advanced in years. Now while he was serving as priest before God when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, it fell to him by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside the hour of incense. And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer is heard. And your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great before the Lord and shall drink no wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the sons of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready for the Lord a people prepared. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Hail, O favored one, the Lord is with you." Here ends the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Christ Jesus the Lord. Amen. Well, grace to you and peace from our Lord and our Savior Jesus the Christ, who was, who is, and who will always be. I'll be having a few things on the screen today, so hopefully you can look at that more than me. You're supposed to laugh anyway. I first want to let you know that we have a verse we want you to learn this first week, and I want you to hold on to it. It's from Luke 11, 9 through 10. So I say to you, ask and it will be given you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks the door will be open. But I want to take it a little bit further, it's not going to be up on the screen, to the 13th verse, where Luke writes, if you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So ask, seek, and knock. And know that what Jesus is really referring to is not earthly things. But what Jesus is referring to is giving his presence to you. And I don't mean presence like you find under a tree, right? I'm talking about the presence of God, which is something we don't think about enough. In Exodus, if I can have a picture up here of Moses and a burning bush, right? In Exodus 3, Moses goes up on a hill looking for a lamb. And as he's on the hill, the mountain of Sinai, looking for a lamb, a bush begins to burn. And all of a sudden, out of the bush, the voice of God comes to him. The bush doesn't burn up, but it's the presence of God. Moses says to himself, I'll go over there and see what's going on. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush. Moses, Moses, he says. Moses said, here I am. Do not come closer. God said, take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. And then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. In Exodus, we begin the journey where fire is one of those pieces that shows us the presence of God. So in a burning bush, we see the presence of God come. But then from the burning bush, the presence of God comes in a pillar, which actually goes above the tent of the tabernacle, eventually as the tabernacle is built. But even more than that, this same pillar leads the way for the people of Israel. This is the presence of God in the midst of the people. That pillar is burning. And I wish you could see it turning and turning, but we can't. But there it is, like a tornado leading the way. I want you to understand, though, that God's fire is presence. And it's not just in the fire that God comes, but God comes through his angels, and God comes to his people. Zechariah was touched by it. I want to back up a little bit. How much do we know about fire? How much do you know about fire? lights up a room. But there's a triangle here. A fire needs fuel. A fire needs heat, something that creates heat, a chain reaction, and it needs oxygen. It needs three things. And then what happens when the fire is established is there's a strange reaction that takes place. It's like a combustion that takes place, and things are set afire, right? So as long as we have oxygen, as long as we have fuel, as long as we have some kind of heat going on to create this, then there's a combustion that happens, a chain reaction, and a fire begins to glow. We have to be careful with that sometimes, right? Because a fire can get out of hand very easily. Sometimes we want the fire out of hand, like a bonfire, right? Just to be in one place. But then there are times that fires can grow outside of where we want it to be. Fuel, that's usually like wood, huh? Or coal. The heat source, oftentimes it's a friction that comes from a match, and the oxygen, which is necessary, we find all around us, don't we? How many of you are breathing right now? Raise your hand. I wouldn't know it by the sounds in this place. So you raise your hand because you're breathing. There's oxygen in the air, and that oxygen, which is all around us, really can be attuned to the presence of our God or God himself. A fuel could be Jesus, in fact, and besides that, there's heat, which livens everything up, which could be the Holy Spirit. So I want you to remember that you need oxygen, you need fuel, and you need heat to start a fire going. How many of us were raised in the 60s and 70s? I know some of you were raised long before us, right? And some of you don't know the song, "It Only Takes a Spark," right? To what?
To get a fire going.
Right, it only takes a spark to get a fire going, but when the fire gets established, it continues to feed off the fuel. It continues to feed off that which is important to get it established. And then the oxygen continues to help it to grow. If you take the oxygen away, what happens? The fire goes out. If you take the fuel away, what happens? The fire goes out. If you don't strike a match, if you don't get it going, the fire won't even be established, right? So I want us to think about the fact that with God, we have, in essence, in his presence, this sense of fire, which we see in the burning bush, correct? Which we see in the pillar. But even beyond that, God's presence comes to Zechariah. And Zechariah is at the temple. He's lighting the incense. The incense is there to remind us of prayer. And as he's praying, somewhat for the people of God, but he's really praying for himself and his wife. He lights the fire, and the smoke comes up, and the angel of God appears to him and tells him that God hears him. Right? God hears him. God hears him. God's presence is all around him. And he's told that he and his wife will have a baby, John the Baptist. Many of us don't even think about that story. We think about Elizabeth as she's ready to deliver almost, and Mary comes to her and sits with her. But we don't think about the fact that there were elderly people who waited for years to give birth and nothing happened. The sense that God didn't hear them, that maybe God's presence wasn't with them, that God's fire had gone out from their life, that God couldn't be seen or felt or understood. But the reality is God's fire was still burning, and God's knowledge was still there, and God's presence was about to be felt in a way that marked the beginning for Jesus to be born. And from Zechariah, Gabriel goes to Mary. And it's the same thing, only Mary wasn't praying for a baby, was she? I don't think Mary was praying for anything at that point other than all of that community prayed in wait for the Messiah to come. But it's been over how many years since David? Over 900 years. Over 500 years since the prophets foretold his birth. They must have felt that God wasn't what? Listening. And that God's presence wasn't there, and that God's fire had disappeared. That God was no longer leading them. But it's important for us to remember that as God comes to us, that flame is still present. And not too many years later, about 30 years after this, 33 years later, God's fire descends upon his people again. That reaction of the fuel, and that reaction of oxygen, that reaction of heat, that reaction of Jesus, that reaction of God the Father, that reaction of the Holy Spirit is all moving at this one time as God's presence descends down upon his people. And it's for this that we wait, my friends. What happens in every single instance, what happens at every turn when God's fire comes, when God's presence is felt, is that there's a combustion that takes place within us as well. What was happening for Moses, what was happening for the people of Israel, what was happening for Zechariah, what was happening for Mary, what happened with the apostles happens with you. There are those moments when we wonder if God is what? Listen. There are those times we wonder if God actually hears us or if God's presence can be felt. Some people long for things that they will never, ever receive for years upon years upon years, as Zechariah and Elizabeth waited. Or as the people of God waited for the coming of the Messiah. What do you wait for? What is it that you're longing for, that fire which is right there all around you, that presence of God is all around you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit feeding you, nourishing you, filling you with that oxygen to set you ablaze, just like it set Zechariah ablaze, or Mary ablaze, or the apostles ablaze, or Moses ablaze to go down into Egypt to say, let my people go. What is the fuel? What is the heat? What is the oxygen? I want to tell you that God surrounds you. God's presence is there, and God evokes out of you something more than to sit. What is a combustion? Anybody ever watch something be set ablaze? It's an amazing thing, isn't it? sometimes it just sits and the embers are still. And all one needs to do is bring a fire a little closer to the embers, and the embers will take off. The embers will be aglow. What are the embers inside of you? How is it we take God's presence into our lives, that we trust in that, that we pray for that, that we long for that? That same thing that Zechariah and Elizabeth longed for, or the same thing that Mary was longing for with the whole people of Israel, that somehow God would give them safety, that God would relieve them, that God would give them life through the Messiah. So how is God's fire there for you? If we were more of a Pentecostal church, you'd all be raising your hands and saying, amen, amen, amen. But we're Lutherans. But I need you to know that God's Spirit is there. Whether you see the fire or not, the fire is present. Christ is there, burning inside of you, burning up inside of you, waiting to push you out of your nest of safety to a new place. So what needs to happen for you and for me? How do you need to grow? What needs to happen? What was Zechariah doing at the temple? Does anyone remember? He was praying at the temple. He was longing at the temple. He was waiting at the temple. We are praying for the coming of Christ. We are longing in the temple for his presence. We are praying that he arrives. So prayer becomes the first part of this journey. And on Wednesday, we'll talk about how that can be refined. But we need to take a little bit from Zechariah today, as he was longing in the temple for God's presence to come. So prayer becomes the beginning of the embers being set on fire to grow, to be established. I don't know about you, I need some kind of chemical reaction today. I drove all day yesterday. What kind of chemical reaction do I need? I need the presence of God around me. I need him like oxygen. I need Jesus like fuel. And I need the Spirit to heat me up from the inside out so that I can be sustained as we do ministry. You need the same thing. So let's take a moment, like Zechariah did at the altar, and pray. Gracious God, combust inside of us. Lift us up, fill us anew with your Spirit. For those who are longing for you, Lord, allow that longing to come to fruition. As Zechariah and Elizabeth waited, O Lord, we wait for you. As the people of Israel waited, we wait for you. We long for what you can bring to our hearts. Lift us up to a new place. Give us new life. Establish us in a new way. And set us free, O God. Set us free to be your ministers in Christ. As we wait. Hear us. Your mercy is great. Amen. Please stand for the Apostles' Creed. Be reminded, O Lord, that we pray for the Spirit, right? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended into hell.
On the third day, he rose again.
He ascended into heaven.
He is seated at the right hand of the Father,
and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As you're seated for the prayers of the church, just a couple of reports. One, Dan Rasmussen's eye surgery went well, but we're still in waiting, right? Okay, but that went well. Also, Marv Gore's surgery on his eye went well, but we still have to wait quite a while for him because he really was blind in that eye. So we continue to pray. The response to the Lord in your mercy is, or hear us, O God. Wait. Lord in your mercy is, hear our prayer. We come before you, O Lord. You are the one who brings a combustion in our life that sets your people on fire. Allow us to glow with you, to be a fire with you. Fill our lungs with your oxygen. Speak to our hearts, Jesus, and fuel us. And we ask, O Lord, that you would give us the heat we need to get off the stove and to do your ministry. Oh Lord, we pray for those in this world who are alone. During the season of Advent into Christmas and following Thanksgiving, we pray for those who are by themselves. Send your people to be with them, to bring them the smile they need, the food to comfort them, to sit in their presence so they are no longer alone. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Oh Lord, we pray for those places that have been scorched by fire. For the mountains here, especially by Estes Park. For California. For all places that fires burn in a destructive way. Be with firefighters, first responders, keeping them safe as they battle flames. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our community, O God. For those at Central High School, those at Hinckley High School, and those who have lost loved ones from shootings over these last weeks. We pray for intervention. We pray for families that are unloving. For children who have no place to go. For children who are longing to be cared for. We ask, O Lord, that our community would stand up. That this violence might stop. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we continue to pray for those who are hurting, for Tim Washington. We ask that you would be with Dolores Rasmussen, as she cares for Dan and worries for Ruth. We pray for your healing, Dan. For George and Sally Odenheimer, for Norma Bryden's stepmom, Patricia.
continue to heal Ryan's arms. We pray for Dolores Collette's brother and wife, Cecil and Marianne. For Ron Freund's sister, Marcia, and she's in the midst of her stem cell recovery from her transplant. For Gina Brisby, my nephew's mom, as she has her stem cell transplant on the 30th. Be with Marvin Bohr as he's recovering from his eye surgery. Be with Wad, who has cancer. We give you thanks that Lisa Daly's brother's cancer is not spread. And we lift up Myrna Ryberg, Sylvia's sister-in-law. For Dennis Clark, as he's in Iowa City. For Sheila Kelly and Jack DeOlivera, as Jack's father passed away. And be with Melody Carter as she broke her elbow. And we pray that you would bring healing. Lord, in your mercy, we give you thanks, O Lord, for Joy Fessing, for Rick and Mark Erickson, for Tim and Linda Washington. Use them for the upbuilding of your church, O God. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we prepare our hearts for communion, O people, prepare your communion. Now the body and blood of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen you, keeping you in his grace, his truth, and his love, now and forever.
Amen.
Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and allow your presence to whirl around us as the pillar whirled in the desert. Guide us and lead us. Open us up to prayer, and give us your insight, O God. Amen. Amen.
Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our closing.
If I had a great confirmation teacher, not.